Hari Om friends, this is Hitesh Khyani here. Welcome once again to my channel Sanatan Dunya, your spiritual home. Sanatan Dunya is a channel focusing on spiritual knowledge or Sanatan Dharma or eternal religion. If you have not already subscribed to my channel, then I suggest you do so, so that you can be updated about forthcoming videos uploaded in this channel. Today, I shall be giving my commentary on a brilliant work of philosophy by Adi Shankaracharya called Brahma Jnanavalli Mala or simply Brahma Jnanavalli. Before I go on to the text of Brahma Jnanavalli, I would like to give a brief introduction to this work that I am going to cover. This Brahma Jnanavalli contains around 14 verses in all, and hence I have divided the work into three parts, which will be covered in three separate videos, so that each video is short and gives ample room for contemplation on the subject matter. Atman refers to the self in the body of every being, whether living or non-living, moving or stationary. Atman means soul or individual self in English. This self is who we are eternally and it is immortal, meaning it cannot be killed or destroyed. Weapons cannot harm it, fire cannot burn it, water cannot wet it, and the wind cannot dry it. We are this immortal self, and we are certainly not the material body that we may sometimes think ourselves to be. This understanding is very, very important. Now, Brahman is the universal aspect of the same being, Atman. Atman is the self at the microcosmic level, and Brahman is the self at the macrocosmic level. In other words, the soul of every individual creature is called Atman, and the soul of the entire creation is called Brahman or God or Supersoul. This Brahman pervades the entire creation. There is no part of creation that does not contain this Brahman or God. According to Vedanta, Atman and Brahman are one and the same. How, one may ask? Saying that Atman and Brahman are one and the same is like saying that wave and ocean are one and the same. Wave is nothing but water, and ocean also is nothing but water. The element of tattva that makes up both the wave and the ocean are one and the same. Similarly, both Atman and Brahman are made up of the same tattva, namely consciousness. The only difference between the Atman that exists at the individual level, whereas Brahman exists universally. Another example might be given that the space within a pot and the total universal space are one and the same. Space is space. The element is the same. There is no separate pot space which is different from the total universal space. So in Brahma Jnanavalli, Adi Shankaracharya describes the pure and original nature of Brahman or the Supreme Self as it exists universally. You are that Brahman, O God. I am that Brahman, O God. And we are all that Brahman, O God. So with this basic understanding of Brahman, we shall now go into the text of Brahma Jnanavalli. The first verse is as follows. Sakara shavana matrena brahma jnanam yato bhave brahma jnanavalli mala sarvesham moksha siddhaye. The translation of this sloka is, the work entitled Brahma Jnanavalli Mala, by hearing which just once knowledge of Brahman is attained, enables all to attain liberation. Here's the commentary. In most of the scriptural works of Vedanta and Hinduism, there is something called Phalashruti, which is the reward that one gets by studying the particular work under consideration. Phalashruti usually comes at the end of each work. However, for this work, Phalashruti is coming at the beginning. A question might arise thus: how is it possible to attain liberation by just listening or studying Brahma Jnanavalli just once? Sounds unrealistic? Well, actually what happens when we hear or study any such work which promises liberation is that the seeds of liberation are sowed upon studying the work under consideration. The seeds being sowed, it requires regular revision and contemplation several times with sincerity for the seed of liberation to grow into a tree of liberation which will yield fruit in the long run. Simply reading such works in a hurry with attention on the fruit of liberation will not produce an immediate effect of liberation. Only the seeds of liberation are sown. So I, Hitesh Khyani, sincerely pray that the seed of liberation may be sowed in the hearts of all seekers who study this work. All the very best. The second sloka is as follows. Asangoham, 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 punah punah, sachidananda rupoham, ahamevaham, avyayah. The translation is, unattached am I, ever free from attachment of any kind. I am of the nature of existence, consciousness, bliss. I am the very self, indestructible and ever unchanging. Commentary is as follows. This work, Brahma Jnanavalli, is the soul which had been sung effortlessly by Adi Shankaracharya in his realization of the truth, and is also applicable in the case of all realized souls who have become the infinity of the being that Brahman is. It is actually meant for all we souls, whether realized or not. And in the case of conditioned souls like most of us, it indicates the natures and qualities which are already there in us and which can be developed further. Upon attaining Brahma Jnana, one becomes unattached to all the events, objects and people in the three worlds. Nothing can bind such a liberated soul who roams around in the mundane world like a lion of self-control and a supreme master of all mystics. Attachment is found almost in the case of most people, if not all people, who have not realized the truth. For example, a child is attached to his parents, his toys, games, his friends, etc. With passing time, these attachments increase and grow stronger. It requires regular and persistent sadhana over several lifetimes to overcome attachment to life and its petty pleasures. The self in a realized soul is free from attachment of every kind, as the sage has realized himself to be the nature of existence, consciousness, bliss. That he is the indestructible self, which is ever unchanging. Change belongs only to the relative universe, but not to its substratum, which is the self. Upon realization, one gets first-hand knowledge of one's unchanging and eternal nature. These truths are affirmed here by Adi Shankaracharya. Let's move on to the next verse. Nityashudbud vimuktoham nirakaroham avyayah bhumananda swarupoham ahamevaham avyayah. So the translation is, I am eternal, I am pure, free from the control of Maya, I am ever liberated, I am formless, indestructible and changeless, I am of the nature of infinite bliss, I am the very self, indestructible and changeless. Commentary of this verse is as follows. The ever-changing world is evanescent and temporary. However, the self is eternal, meaning it is without beginning or end. This concept of eternity needs to be contemplated upon. Even if one takes his mind back zillions of years back into the past, one will still not be able to reach the so-called beginning of time, as time is without beginning or end. The concept of eternity is intimately concerned with the concept of infinity that Brahman represents. Only that which is infinite can be eternal. All the worlds from Brahmaloka down to Patala are temporary, as they are limited and are realms of experience. However, the substratum of the creation, which is the Supreme Self, is infinite and eternal. In fact, eternity is a term for the infinity of time alone. The Self in all is eternally pure. This is more so in the case of a realized soul, and hence Adi Shankaracharya expresses that he is pure and that he has realized it. An ordinary mortal like any of us may sometimes consider ourselves to be impure due to certain disturbing and impious thoughts and habits. But the Self that we are is eternally pure, completely unaffected by any gross impurities which may exist at the level of the jiva. All this purity is already there in all of us. Still, it needs to be realized by us so that we can revel in the state of supreme bliss forever. The next truth which Adi Shankaracharya states in this verse is that we are ever liberated, meaning muktoham in Sanskrit. There is a belief entertained by certain Vedantins that there is no bondage for the soul at any time, because the Self is knowledge and is ever unchanging and therefore must necessarily be free at all times. This intrinsic freedom of the Self is affirmed here and will be tangibly realized upon self-realization. There is also a verse from the Ashtavakra Gita which states that if one considers oneself to be bound, then one is bound. If one considers oneself to be free, then one is free. The belief that thinking makes it so is true. The next verse is as follows. Nityoham niravadyoham nirakaroham achyutah paramananda rupoham ahamevaham avyayah. The translation of this verse is as follows. I am eternal, I am free from blemish, I am formless, I am indestructible and changeless. I am of the nature of supreme bliss. I am the very Self, indestructible and changeless. The commentary of this verse is as follows. Once again, the self-realized soul affirms that he is eternal, and this is true for all these souls too. As I explained earlier, the Self that we are is eternal, meaning it is without beginning or end. Our bodies have a beginning and an end. The world has a beginning and an end, but the Self that is a substratum of the whole creation and which is who we are, is without beginning or end. Hence, the eternal nature of the Self that we are is affirmed here. Blemishes or limitations are imposed upon the Self by the Lord's Maya. It is the responsibility of the jiva to overcome these blemishes through self-effort. Upon self-realization, one discovers oneself to be free from blemishes and perfect. Here, perfection does not refer to perfection in action, but perfection in intention. In this verse, Adi Shankaracharya also goes on to affirm that as the Self, we are formless. Our bodies have a form, our minds take the form of objects, but the Self that we are is a substratum of all forms, and hence it has to be formless. It is formless. So once again it is affirmed here that one is formless, indestructible and changeless, and that the Self is of the nature of supreme bliss. So friends, here ends the first part of my commentary on Brahma Jnanavalli. I hope you benefited from the wisdom presented in this work, and I also request you to please watch the second and third parts of the same Brahma Jnanavalli, which I will be uploading in two more parts in a few days' time. Thank you very much. Have a great day. Hari Om.